Hello everyone, this is Abhishek Mahanti and you are watching Padarth Vigyan. So students, welcome to lecture number 10 of the chapter Electric Potential and Capacitance. In this lecture, we will discuss about these three important topics. The first one is the self-energy of a charged spherical cell. The second one is the self-energy of a charged solid sphere. And the third one is the self and interaction energy of two spheres. So let's get started. So students, first we will discuss about the self-energy of a charged spherical cell. And we have to understand what is the meaning of self-energy of a charged body. So look at this diagram here. We have a spherical cell of radius r. Let us consider that capital R is the radius of the cell. Radius of the cell. And suppose we want to give charge to this cell. Suppose the maximum amount of charge that can be stored on the surface of the cell is capital Q. Capital Q is the maximum amount of charge. Maximum amount of charge on the cell. So initially this cell was uncharged, it was neutral, and we will bring the charges from infinity and we will distribute the charges on the surface of the cell. And in this process some work has to be done. That work, the work done to completely charge the cell is stored as the energy or the self energy of this spherical cell. So in order to calculate the self energy, we have to calculate what is the work done to completely charge this spherical cell, and that work done is equal to the energy stored or the self energy of this spherical cell. So students, we have assumed that capital R is the radius of the cell and capital Q is the maximum amount of charge that can be stored on the surface of the cell. Remember that this is a spherical cell, so whatever charge will be supplied, all the charges will lie on the surface. No charge will lie inside the cell. Is that clear? So now we are going to derive the expression for work done. So let us assume that we are bringing the charges from infinity and we are distributing the charges on the surface of the cell. Let at any instant the charge on the cell is equal to small q. During the process of charging, let us assume that at any instant the charge on the cell is small q. And if capital R is the radius of the cell, now tell me what will be the potential on the surface of the cell. So I can write that potential on the surface of the cell, on the surface of the cell is equal to how much? V equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by capital R. We have already derived this formula, electric potential due to a spherical cell. So if at any instant the charge on the cell is small q, then the potential on the surface is given by this expression V equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R. Now if you want to add a small amount of charge dQ on the surface, then you have to do some work. So what is the expression for the work done? Small work done to add a small amount of charge, small amount of charge dQ to the surface. What is the work done? dW is equal to V into dQ. So we know that if at a point we have some potential and we want to add some charge, then we have to do some work. The work done is equal to potential into the charge. So V into dQ is the small amount of work done to add a small amount of charge to the surface of the shell. So what is V? V is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by capital R, and then we have to multiply dQ here. So to add dQ amount of charge, we have to do this amount of work done. Is that clear? Now we have to find what is the total work done to completely charge the shell. Total amount of work done, total amount of work done to completely charge the shell, to completely charge the shell will be how much? W is equal to integration of dW. The limit will be from 0 to W. And what is dW? dW is this much. So let us put this value, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R into dQ. And here the limits will be from 0 to capital Q, because initially the cell was uncharged and finally we will completely charge the cell. And we have assumed that capital Q is the maximum amount of charge that can be stored on the surface of the cell. So the limits will be from 0 to capital Q. And now you can take this 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught R outside, because these are constant quantities. So you will get integration of Q dQ. The limits are from 0 to capital Q. That implies W is equal to how much? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught R. Integration of Q dQ will be Q square by 2, and the limits are from 0 to capital Q. So that is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught R. If you put the upper limit, you will get Q square by 2, minus if you put the lower limit, you will get 0, 0 square by 2 or 0. So finally the answer will be how much? It will be Q square by 8 pi epsilon naught R. So we have to do this amount of work to completely charge the spherical cell, and this work is stored as the self energy of the spherical cell. So the self energy of the spherical cell, is how much? U is equal to W, that is equal to Q square by 8 pi epsilon naught R. So this is the expression for the self energy of a spherical cell. So students, I hope that you have understood the derivation of the self energy. Now we are going to derive the self energy of a charged solid sphere. So now we will discuss about the second one, the self energy of a charged solid sphere. So you can see that there are four diagrams here. The first diagram represents a solid sphere. This is a non-conducting solid sphere, and initially this solid sphere is uncharged. The total charge here is 0. Q is equal to 0. Okay. Now finally, look at the fourth diagram. Finally, this sphere will be fully charged. You can see that the charges will be distributed uniformly throughout the volume. And here we have assumed that R is the radius. Capital R is the radius of the sphere, and capital Q is the maximum charge in the sphere. So this is the case of a volume charge distribution. And we know that if R is the radius of a sphere, then its volume is 4 by 3 pi R cube. And if we will distribute a charge capital Q throughout the volume, then the volume charge density rho will become how much? Q by 4 by 3 pi R cube. And this is equal to 3 Q by 4 pi R cube. So I have shown you the first diagram and the fourth diagram. In the first diagram, the total charge is 0 in the fourth trigram, or finally we'll get a fully charged sphere. But figure number 2 and figure number 3 we'll discuss right now. So initially we had no charge on the sphere, and we are continuously supplying the charges to this sphere. So the charge in the sphere will increase from 0 to q. The charge on the in the sphere will increase from 0 to q. So suppose, imagine that in the process of charging, at any instant charge in the sphere is equal to q. So we are continuously supplying charges to this sphere, and remember that when the sphere will be completely charged, will be fully charged, then the total charge will be capital Q. But during the process of charging, suppose at any instant the charge in the sphere is small q, and assume that this charge small q is distributed in a spherical manner like this. The charges are distributed in a spherical volume, and suppose that this radius of this sphere is x. Okay, so whatever charge we have given, charge q, and this charge is distributed inside this spherical volume, and the radius of the sphere is suppose x. Is that clear? Now tell me, what will be the potential at this point? Means we have to imagine a sphere, and whatever charge is supplied to the sphere, that charge is arranged in a spherical manner like this, shown in the figure number 2, and the radius of the sphere is x. So tell me, what will be the potential at this point P? So the potential at point P, or I can write that potential on the surface of imaginary sphere, on the surface of imaginary sphere will be how much? V equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by x. So now if you want to add an extra amount of charge dq, a small amount of charge dq to the sphere, then you have to do some work. Because now look at the second diagram here. The whatever charges we have supplied a small q amount of charges, and all these charges are distributed in the form of a spherical volume. So in figure number 3, I will draw the same sphere again. So this sphere has a radius x. Let me show you the radius. So this radius is x. Okay, now if you want to add a further amount of charge dq, then that charge dq will lie outside this sphere, outside this imaginary sphere. So if we add a small amount of charge dq, then what will we get? We'll get a slightly increased radius. We'll get another sphere of slightly increased radius like this, because already in this region the charges are distributed. So whatever extra charge will supply, that will lie in a small volume like this. This is the small volume in which we'll get the extra dq amount of charge. I hope that you are understanding what I am saying. Again, I am repeating. So during the process of charging, suppose assume that at an instant we have supplied q amount of charge to the sphere, and all the charges are arranged in a spherical volume of radius x. Now the potential on this on the surface of this imaginary sphere is given by this value 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by x. Now if you want to add some extra amount of charge dq, then those charges will lie outside the imaginary sphere, and they will make this kind of elementary volume. And if you measure the radius, if you measure the radius of this slightly larger sphere, this radius, it will be x plus dx. It will be x plus dx. It means the thickness, this thickness is how much? The thickness is dx. Okay. So now tell me, we are talking about uniform charge distribution. It means the volume charge density is same everywhere. So to add extra dq amount of charge, extra dq amount of charge to the sphere, work done will be how much? Dw is equal to V into dq. So we got that dw is equal to V into dq, and this V is the potential on the surface of the imaginary sphere. So we know that V is equal to how much? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by x, and then we have to multiply dq. Now we have to write the expression for this dq. So how to write the expression for dq? Just look at the diagram here. I had told you that whatever extra amount of charge will be supplied to the sphere, that charge will remain in this green colored element, in this green colored element. And the thickness of this green colored element is dx. So what is the volume? The volume of the element will be volume of the element is how much? That is equal to 4 pi x square into dx, 4 pi x square dx, because the area of the sphere is 4 pi x square and the thickness is dx. So the volume will be 4 pi x square dx. And if rho is the volume charge density, then dq will be equal to 4 pi x square dx into rho. And now tell me, what is the value of q? The q amount of charge is distributed throughout this spherical volume of radius x. Then q will be equal to volume of the sphere, 4 by 3 pi x cube into the volume charge density rho. So we have written expression for q and expression for dq. Now write the expression for dw. That will be equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. In place of q, you can write 4 by 3 pi x cube into rho, and then you have divided by x. And in place of dq, you can write 4 pi x square dx into rho. So 4 pi will cancel, and then x and x square will cancel. You'll get one x here. So finally, you'll get dw is equal to how much? So 4 pi rho divided by 3 epsilon naught x to the power 4 dx. Yes, you'll get dw equal to 4 pi, you'll get rho square, because we have two rows, rho and rho here. So you'll get 4 pi rho square divided by 3 epsilon naught into x to the power 4 dx. So this is the small amount of work done to add a small charge dq. Now we have to find the total work done. The total work done will be how much? W is equal to integration of dw from 0 to w, and take all these constant terms like 4 pi rho square by 3 epsilon naught outside, and then integrate x to the power 4 dx. The limits will be from 0 to capital R, because R is the radius of this solid sphere. So now the integration is very easy. W equal to 4 pi rho square by 3 epsilon naught. Integration of x to the power 4 dx will be x to the power 5 by 5, and put the limits from 0 to R, so what will you get? Okay, so now you will get W is equal to 4 pi rho square divided by 3 epsilon naught R to the power 5 by 5 minus 0 to the power 5 by 5 will be 0, so leave that. So this is the expression for work done. Now we will slightly rearrange this expression. So how to write it? So first I'll write 4 by 3. I'll take this 4, I'll take this 3, 4 by 3, then I'll take this pi, 4 by 3 pi, and from this r to the power 5 I'll take r to the power 3, and from this rho square I'll take rho. Okay, so 4 by 3 pi r cube rho. If I write these quantities separately, then I will be left with rho, then r to the power 2 by 5 epsilon naught. Okay, so what is the value of this one? 4 by 3 pi r cube rho will be capital Q, because 4 by 3 pi r cube is the total volume of the sphere, and if you multiply the volume charge density, you will get the total charge, that is Q. And then I have left with this rho r square by 5 epsilon naught. Now I'll do one thing. I will multiply 4 by 3 and then I'll multiply 3 by 4 so that they'll cancel each other, and then I will multiply 1 r, so we'll get r to the power 3, and divide r. R square can be written as r to the power 3 by r. Okay, and then I will multiply a pi and divide a pi, and then I have this 5 epsilon naught. So what is the reason behind all these things? And yes, I have one rho here. So what is the reason behind writing the expression like this? I will tell you. So this is Q, and let us take this 3 by 4 and then 5 pi epsilon naught, and then we'll be left with this 4 by 3, then pi r cube rho. So 4 by 3 pi r cube rho. Okay, so again this quantity is also capital Q, so I will get 3 by 20 pi epsilon naught Q into Q, Q square. Q into Q is Q square. So finally we'll get the expression. Yes, I have left R here. Yes, this is the, we have an R here. So we'll get 3 Q square divided by 20 pi epsilon naught R. So this is more organized expression. So we have derived the expression for work done, W equal to 3 Q square by 20 pi epsilon naught R, and this work is stored as the self energy of this sphere, of this uniformly charged sphere. So U is equal to how much? 3 Q square by 20 pi epsilon naught R. So students, just look at the expression for the self energy of a spherical cell. So we got that. Let me write here at the top, let me write all these formulas. So remember that if we have a spherical cell, then U is equal to how much? Q square by 8 pi epsilon naught R. And for a solid sphere, U is equal to 3 Q square by 20 pi epsilon naught R. And you can see that all the terms in this expression are positive. We have Q square positive, 8 pi epsilon naught R, all are positive quantities. So remember that the self energy of a spherical cell or of a solid sphere are always positive. Always positive. Now we'll talk about the final topic, which is the self and interaction energy of two spheres. So the next topic is self and interaction energy of two spheres. So I'll give you one example. Suppose I have a solid sphere and I have a spherical cell. I have a solid sphere and a spherical cell. And suppose this solid sphere is positively charged. This solid sphere is positively charged, and the total amount of charge in this sphere is Q1, and this spherical cell is negatively charged. Assume that this is negatively charged. Since the second one is a cell, the charges will lie on the surface. And suppose minus Q2 is the charge on this spherical cell. And again, assume that the radius of the cell is B, and the radius of this solid sphere is A. Okay, and the distance between their centers, the distance between their centers is, let us say, L. Okay. Or write R. Suppose the distance between their centers is R. Now, what is the total energy of the system? So the total energy of the system means this is the sum of the self energy of the solid sphere plus the self energy of the spherical cell and the interaction energy between the two charged bodies. So the first body is a solid sphere and it has a radius A. So and it carries a positive charge Q1. So what will be the value of U1? So look at this formula for solid sphere. So it will be 3 Q1 square divided by 20 pi epsilon naught A, because A is the radius of the solid sphere and U2 is the self energy of the spherical cell. So look at this formula. I can write that U2 is Q2 square divided by 8 pi epsilon naught B. And what is U12? So we can assume that these two charged spherical bodies, they behave like point charges. So the charge on the spherical cell is minus Q2, the charge on the solid sphere is Q1, and we know that if we have two point charges Q1 and Q2 at a distance r from each other, this is minus Q2, then the energy will be how much? K Q1 into minus Q2 divided by r. So I can write this expression 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 into minus Q2 divided by R. So that is equal to 3 Q1 square divided by 20 pi epsilon naught A plus Q2 square by 8 pi epsilon naught B and minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 Q2 by R. And this last term is the interaction energy. The last term is the interaction energy. So remember that the self energy is always positive, but the interaction energy can be positive, can be negative. If we take two like charges, then the interaction energy will be positive. If we take two unlike charges, then the interaction energy will be negative. So students, that's all for today's class. I hope that you have understood all these concepts that we had discussed in this lecture. So we had discussed these three important topics. If you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment section. So again, we'll meet in the next class. Till then, have a nice day and bye bye.